Rebonjour. So today is the third part of the seminary. I'm glad you're here. And I've done a first discussion mainly on politics and a little bit geopolitics with the US and China. Yesterday we were more on social issues and economics. And today I'm going to finish with the more focusing more on culture and content. So basically politics, economics and culture. Of course it's a very short summarize of several years of research. I don't want to do my own promotion, but it's true that you will find much more analysis, examples and a very long research, especially in my next book, which is kind of a premiere here, that will be published in Spanish, I think, in November by Taurus, and I hope it will be available at the library here and also in the bookshop. Today I will begin by again an example, an image, and the example I pick among actually dozens, maybe hundreds I could have taken, and I don't take one in Mexico because I think it's better to go a little bit elsewhere with you. The place name is El Ateneo Grand Splendid. It's a marvelous place, Grand Splendid. And the place by itself has been a summarize of culture and the entertainment during the century. The place has been in the beginning, a place for the beginning of the 20th century, a place for shows, big shows, sometimes Broadway shows, theater with a lot of people on stage, very big stage. Then step by step it became useless and it was transformed as a movie theater. One of these big movie theaters, you know, I don't know Mexico very well, but in the US you have in all the big cities, especially in the 30s, in the 40s, this very huge folk theater, for example, and it was places where you can see movies. In the beginning they were without voice, as you know, and then they begin to speak. And this Grand Splendid is the name of the place. Has been an extremely famous place for movies until the 60s. And then, as you know, the movie theater left quite often the center of the city and were more transformed in multiplexes. You can see many movies and not just one at one time. And basically the movie theater, this big movie theater, was not very used, and it was transformed in a bookshop, very big bookshop, of course, because you can imagine how big was the movie theater at 1860 Avenue Santa Fe in the center downtown of Buenos Aires in Argentina. And it still exists, you can go there, 1860 Avenue Santa Fe, El Ateneo Grand Splendid. It's probably one of the more beautiful bookshop in the world. I've been there because I had a meeting with somebody, and you see tons of CDs, tons of DVDs, and of course books from every country's languages, mainly of course in Spanish. And this place has a specific thing, the stage which was used for the plays, Broadway shows, and movie theater is a cafe. So it's kind of strange because you're on the stage in the cafe and you see this vast, very beautiful bookshop, and to every floor you can get some specialized bookshop on like social science and philosophy, foreign languages, dictionaries, and so on and so forth. And I had a meeting some months ago, I mean actually probably a year and a half ago, with a guy who was the founder of Taringa, You might know Taringa or you might not. It's a website. And we were on the stage having some coffee, watching all these beautiful books, CDs, DVDs. And in one moment in our conversation, he said, yes, I was happy to meet you here because our offices are just in some floor upstairs. And we were watching the place and he said, you know, all that will disappear. We are the future of culture. Of course, it's just an image. Taringa, at least for now, is not the... I mean, the books are still existing, the CD basically not, less and less. DVDs probably will disappear as well. Books, we'll see. But it was interesting to be at that place, and it wasn't, I mean, he just set up the appointment there. So it was kind of a coincidence to be with this guy, founder of one of the websites, Taringa, and basically thinking of, after like the place have been a place for a Broadway show, then a movie theater, then a bookshop, that maybe a Taringa something. And he said, we are already in the building, so we are ready for the next step of culture. Taringa, among many other websites in the world, is interesting. It's a kind of mix of Facebook and also a bit Twitter. And it's also, in a way, also Amazon, a small Amazon, because you can buy content on the website. If you want to send a tweet through Taringa, they call it shoots. And of course, you can do reshoots. And the number of signs you use for the shoots are 256. Signs, you know, for Twitter is 240, so it's pretty close. For some parts of the website, they said before Facebook on bringing content on their timeline, cultural content. I'm not able to double check that, but I trust them. What is interesting is that in this Taringa website, and again, we can have many other examples all around the world, like Flipkart in India. We will speak about Ozon or Contacte in Russia, Orkut in Brazil. I will come back on Orkut soon. All these examples shows that you can have many different websites in the world. But with Taringa, I saw some interesting things. First, you can subscribe to some content and then pay for the subscription. Then you can have some recommendations. Of course, you can do that also on Facebook, but still it's interesting. They use a strong algorithm that can help you to give you some recommendation about content. They want to create a conversation between the people. And also, they are thinking on new form of copyright with some content that are without a real copyright or use a copyright license called Creative Commons. So basically, subscription, recommendation, algorithm, conversation, new copyright form are several of the aspects of this new cultural form that I want to discuss today. But before going on these different examples, I want to take a counterexample of Taringa, which is Orkut in Brazil. Orkut have been created, and you might know Orkut, you might have used it. I don't know if it was very popular in Mexico or not, but it was very popular in Brazil, and actually also in India, and in some other places in the world. Orkut was basically created before Facebook, and it could have been a kind of model for Google to create his own social network, because it was created by a Google guy in Brazil, and actually it became a little bit the model of Google Plus, but it was too late to be a real competitor of Facebook. And on Orkut, they used basically the same kind of things that Facebook does, except that it is very, it's a kind of a little bit cheap. I mean, I don't want to be mean, but was cheap in several aspects. But they were pretty innovative, pretty early on. And in the beginning, it was extremely successful among the elite, the Brazilian elite. They wanted to have the account, the Orkut account. And then step by step, it was so successful that the elite was joined by the B class and then the C class. So the middle class were very happy to come and to have also an account on Orkut. And Orkut was, in several aspects, I create one account myself. I don't use it a lot, but at least I've seen how it works. You can put also your content, control content, and some recommendations step by step. And then the class C people join Orkut, and then the more D and E classes also wanted to be on Orkut. And because of that, of course, the class A decided to move to Facebook. And then the B class did the same. And then the C class followed the B class and the A class. And step by step, Orkut became, let's say, what they call Orkut in Brazilian, the Orkutization of Orkut, which means basically square and a little bit cheesy. There is several other aspects that explain why Orkut didn't work at the end, even though it was very successful. And I would say 5-7 years ago, it was more important than Facebook in Brazil. And even in India, they had a huge impact. Another explanation of the difficulties of Orkut is how they weren't able to move quickly to the smartphone. So they were pretty strong on PC and computers, but they weren't able to immediately understand, think that the future of social network will be on smartphone. And then the apps and all these things were not very, easy to use on smartphone. And then there is another explanation, which is a bit on contradiction with the theory I gave you 2 days ago about what I think about the future of the internet. It's that, you know, you want to follow, let's say, Lady Gaga, maybe not you, maybe not me, but some people want. And, you know, Lady Gaga was on Facebook. She wasn't on Orkut. Ricky Martin ended up being on Orkut, and Shakira also. But it's true that especially a lot of superstar, global superstar, TV, network were not on Orkut. So when you want to be global and at the same time still in Brazil, Facebook was necessary. So you had to switch from the two accounts. And in addition of that, as you know, a lot of Brazilian and especially Indian as well were studying in the US. When you're in the US, I mean, your friends are on Facebook, they are not on Orkut. So basically, it shows that content can be still extremely national in your language, but sometimes you need that the software will be more global, at least to be able to communicate with the other people. And I wanted to give you this Orkut example because it shows that sometimes we will see if Taringa will become like the huge social network and at the same time a kind of Facebook and a kind of Amazon for Argentina. But it might success by the content they give, but fail because of the platform is not enough global to be able to create link between different people. Then I want to go to some more longer description about the future of culture. And we have seen already a certain number of things. I summarize what I've said in the first seminar. Internet becomes more mobile. Everybody knows that. TV becomes as well more smart, and social TV is more important than before. And internet evolves in many directions. Mobility, we have said that. Wearable tech, and so on and so forth. Culture used to be a product. And think about that. Before, to be able to see a movie, you had to get the copy of the movie. I mean, sometimes you were waiting 6 months, 10 months to get the first release of the movie in a different country than the US, for example. Today, the movie arrives in your country even before it's released on theaters. So the culture where the product, it needed goes to go across borders, it needed train and boat, I mean, maybe not train in Mexico because you don't have so many trains, but trains, boats, airplanes, whatever, to transport and to move culture. Books has to be bring to the people, and CDs and DVD as well. So it was a product, and it is now a service. It goes from product to services to streams to what we call format sometimes, and so on and so forth. So this is an important move. Another thing is, and I will go back on that, the subscription model. I will go back on that soon. So basically, content streams are extremely influent. We don't know yet what will be the future of that, of course, but we can imagine that the idea of having a subscription in an unlimited way with a small amount of money to pay every month and to get everything by streaming through the cloud could be one example, could be the future of culture. And once again, I understand very well that some scholar, the one I had some debate, sometimes fight a bit with, in France, Alain Finkielkraut or Marc Fumaroli, I had a fight also with Vargas Llosa in Latin America. It's also the debate with Raphael Simon in Italy and so on. It's because, of course, when you are like this kind of scholar that used to go to bookshops and libraries for years working on archive, and suddenly somebody arrives and says, you know, culture will be a streaming service, unlimited, unlimited on the cloud, they are a bit afraid. And you have to understand that. At the same time, my goal is not to be against anyone or to be against culture. It's just to see what's going on right now and where we are going to. So to come back on this idea of an unlimited subscription content services through the cloud, I want to take the example of Amazon. And to be pretty much to avoid the debate about, you know, Amazon as an American corporation, by definition, you're Mexican, I'm French, this is a bad guy, we are good. I will take three examples that are Amazon, but not the Amazon we know. I will talk a bit about Flipkart, Ozon, and Contacte. They are Amazon, but in other country, in India, in Russia, and I can add also, if you want, some example in China. If you go to India, you will see that Flipkart is an extremely big corporation. This is the Amazon for India. And the expression Amazon for India, by definition, shows that this is big. Flipkart right now is not able to deliver books everywhere in the country. You know, there is more than 100,000 villages in India, so they don't have the ability, they don't have the means to go everywhere. So they limit their distribution to big cities. But it's already several hundred of million of people that can be reached by Flipkart. And because India is a country where the mail is not that organized, they had to create their own distribution of mailing system for their own Flipkart product. And it's funny because they are organized exactly like Amazon. They began with books, CD and DVDs, and now they are evolving to many other products that they want to sell through their websites. For now, it's essentially a product distributor, so they don't do a lot of streaming, but they will get on that pretty soon. So they sell books and other products everywhere in India. And of course, they are booming everywhere. People are buying a lot of books through this system. And they are also creating an algorithm like Amazon to try to predict what you're going to buy. And they use that in a way that helps you to, I mean, basically to know what you like. If we take the example of Ozon, it's exactly the same one in Russia. And basically also they began with books and they do now other products. You should know that in Russia, the first sale through emails were websites dedicated to pieces of car. How do you say that? Yes, it's like, you know, when you have a car, you need sometimes to change some part of the car. And the most famous website is dedicated only on that, because in Russia, I don't know, they don't have probably the first-hand cars as many as we have. And so basically they buy second-hand cars and they need to repair them all the time. So it's the most popular website there. And the second more popular one, which is kind of amazing and just don't understand why, it's a website, I cannot say that in Russian, I don't speak Russian, but basically it's fridge.com if you want. It's for only to sell fridge. I don't know why in Russia, where it's so cold, they are so interested by fridge, but probably they need fridge like everywhere in the world. But Ozon is basically the third one after the auto repair website and then the fridge car website. And they basically sell books and many other products. And like in India, they had to build their network to basically be able to deliver books and other products to Russian people. And also another singularity, you cannot pay, I mean you can pay, but basically the people don't trust the web. It's true in China, it's true in India, it's true in Russia. They don't want to give their Visa card, and quite often they don't necessarily have a Visa card. So basically it's a strange system where you order through the internet, you get your product by the Ozon Corporation that delivers to you, and you pay in cash when the product arrives. Because Russians don't want to pay without seeing if it's correct or not. And it's pretty successful. And Kontakt, which is more of a Facebook in Russia, goes right now toward the direction of delivering also books and other products. And you have many other examples. I can take, as you know, Alibaba in for example, in China, which is a very big website. And if I took these three, four examples, it's because then you see that Amazon is not the problem by itself. Because in India, in Russia, in China, you have also the same kind of websites. So when, for example, the French are upset against Amazon, The reality is that everywhere we will have something like Amazon, either it is Amazon or it's you call it another way. Maybe in Mexico you will prefer to have I don't know Sandbox or something like that that will deliver you the books. Maybe not. Maybe in France we want that to be a Fnac or something like that. But at the end it will be a little bit the same. So the future of the culture is not the problem with Amazon, is more the problem with this kind of big website that are able to create and distribute books and other products very quickly through the internet. Of course, either at Ozon, Flipkart, Alibaba, and of course Amazon, they know already what is the next story. And the next story is not to deliver product, it will be to deliver services. So basically, they are already ready, and Amazon is probably the first one in the world to be able to do that, to deliver to you directly to your computer books online, e-books, music, movies, and actually all the cultural products that becomes that are now services. So we can imagine, it's not yet the case, we'll see. It's an hypothesis that you will subscribe to this Amazon, let's say premium, which already exists, premium website subscription, and through the cloud you will get access to tons of books, CD, DVDs, actually films, not DVDs, and even video game. You know that Amazon is also pretty strong on video games already. There is today, for each sector, competitors. For the music, we know Pandora. I don't know if Pandora is available in Mexico. I think it's just in the US. But you can get Spotify, you probably get Deezer, Cobuzz. There is at least 10 big players in the game. Some are American, like Pandora. The other are European. Some others exist. There is some in China, some in Japan, some in South Korea. For video games, it's the platform Steam, but there is some others, a little bit Amazon. For books, you have Amazon Premium, but you have also Scrib or Oyster. For movie, of course, you have Netflix. Even though Netflix is a little bit cheesy in Mexico and is going to be launched pretty soon in France, I don't know if they will succeed everywhere in the world, but at least the Netflix model has an impact. All these examples, all these websites, services, works with the cloud, and we can believe that Amazon could be the only one to aggregate all of them. It's an hypothesis, we'll see if it works or not. But in any case, you might not know that, but when you use Netflix, which is one of the main competitors of Amazon, you use at the same time Amazon. Because Netflix doesn't have the network of computer to deliver to you the movie. So they basically use the Amazon cloud services to work with you. So you see how powerful is Amazon. Even we have known recently that the NSA use Amazon to stock some data because they don't have the capability to stock that by themselves. So the interesting point in all that, whether it's an Amazon all you can eat, if I can say that, service with book, music, video games, and movies, either it will be separate with Netflix, Spotify, Steam, and maybe some other services, we are going to go in this direction. One singularity that we can see in all of that, it's of course the use of the algorithm. If you take Netflix, for example, a very smart scholar in the US was able to find that Netflix use an algorithm with 79,000 categories, and you are put in one of them. And actually, you know that yourself when you use Spotify or Deezer or Pandora. You are basically, step by step, known as liking one kind of music. For example, when I wrote my book Smart, I don't know why, that time, that summer, I was very interested, I write quite often at night, and for hours I was listening soul music, you know, especially the Motown, these kind of things. And I listened for hours Motown music and so on, and now I'm stuck in the soul music. So whenever I want to hear some classical music, they don't allow me. They don't give me any advice or any recommendation on rap or classical or jazz, because for them, I am the guy who likes only soul music and Motown music. It's funny, but I'm not able to escape this category. Maybe some reaction on all that, on recommendation. I will go back on that pretty soon. Somebody has his own comment. What do you think about this evolution? Take some water, not to die in front of you.
Okay. Well, since probably for my previous comments in the last 2 days of this seminar, you may imagine that I'm going to ask about political economy of media. In this respect, I would like to ask you, what do you think about, because you're talking precisely about very particular corporations that have a big presence in the internet, or in the cloud services. But what is this? What about the impact of this media concentration in also by means of internet? Because we were certainly sure that this happened in the analogous media, and now in the digital media is happening again. This kind of concentration of ownership. So, what is your point of view of what actually will happen? This will be still be creating a big conglomerate of corporations, or probably we will see a kind of chiasm of different corporations trying to take a piece of the pie.
Right now, honestly, Amazon is, I think we underestimate for a long time the capability and the power of Amazon in this sector. We have seen it as mainly a bookstore and then selling a little bit everything. I don't think they are going to stop to that. And in the same way that Netflix began with the DVDs, you know, in the red mail, they switched suddenly to streaming movies and they were able to succeed in this direction. So, and for now, the products are still very important in Amazon revenue, so they are not going to stop that immediately. But if, I mean, they have the Kindle, as you know, they have the phone and so on. So the day they want to go to switch to content that will be only digital, which already they do through the premium subscription, but which is still very little in comparison of the market they get. I don't see anyone that really has the ability to be a competitor. So the risk, of course, is monopoly. And to go more on the detail, I want to focus maybe for a few minutes on music. If you take music, there is basically today three models. I mean, let's forget the CD. Whatever is a CD, it won't survive. And even, by the way, for movies, I don't believe once again on the DVD and even the Blu-ray, because you know it will be through internet for sure. So the music today, the three models are the iTunes model, where you buy a title or an album through and you download it. This model has been extremely important in the last couple of years, but we are at the end of this model. Basically the people won't buy music title by title, not even album by album. And this is why actually the Amazon model is much stronger than the iTunes model. Then you have the model we can call the radio model, which is actually the smart radio model. So, and it's a very different one than the subscription model. The radio model in general is free. You can listen for free, sometimes with advertisements, sometimes even without, but you cannot really choose the title you're gonna hear. So basically you will say, like me, I like soul music, and you will get Motown music all the time, but you won't say, I want this specific album of Aretha Franklin, let's say, of that year. This is a radio model, and the way it pays artists is very different than the third model, which is a subscription one. And actually, for the artist, the subscription model is the best. I mean, the really best is iTunes, but if iTunes won't work, the subscription is better. So the radio model will survive whatsoever, because radio has been forever something we need. It's also a way to discover new music. It's also a way to be able to open your ears to other styles of music and so on and so forth. So, and then you have the subscription model, which is basically Pandora. In Europe, we have Spotify, Deezer, Qobuz, as I said. The quality is better, more and more. Qobuz, for example, is an extremely good quality. It's better than the CD one. And it works with a subscription. Sometimes it's a mix with the radio. For example, in Spotify, you can get the Spotify radio, where basically they give you the music you want, but without deciding the precise title. And then you can choose a real title, and then it's the model of subscription. So you have both can work all together. And it's without publicity or with publicity, depending if you pay and what amount you pay every month. The interesting point with this model, which basically is right now what the industry thinks will be the future of music for one large part, is that people pay. The cost is not very high. And actually, you don't want to pay to buy every single you want to hear. But when you get for $9 a month, all the music on all your devices, and you don't even have to think about, you know, not even thinking about the risk of piracy, but just how you download, how you keep, and so on. You have access on all your devices in your car, in your bedroom, in your apartment, in another house of the music. It works. Of course, for the artist, it's not a very good model for now, and unless we have enough people, millions of people that will subscribe. So we'll see a little bit what will be the free model evolutions. In any case, and I believe exactly in the same way for books and writers, and it's probably the same also for video games and other sectors, we need to think of new models to pay the musician and to pay also the writers. In the music sector, many things have been done. Of course, you know, the live sector is booming, so you can see the artist live and you pay the ticket for the concert. There is all the, you know, in Asia, it's everybody buy ringtones, and they have very interesting things that sometimes, for example, you call somebody, and during your call, you have the music. So it's a different one, and you have to pay for that one. I'm kind of surprised that when you speak to somebody, you want to hear some music, but it's something they do. And there is also, of course, the waiting music. So for a single call, you can have free music, the ringtone music, the waiting music, and then the music during your conversation. So it's free way to pay the artist. In South Korea, they are crazy about that. They have a lot of imagination of things they can create and do. And then you have the model of crowdfunding. You know that probably better. I mean, you know that very well. Which I think it's a great, an extremely good model for up-and-comings. You know, you have a guy, like, let's say, a group. I'm sure there is a musician in the room. You play music. You're already pretty much famous on this campus, but not even on the campus in Monterrey or in Mexico. So you need a little bit promotion and so on. So then you ask crowdfunding for your friends and family, and more than that, maybe all the students in the campus. You get some money, you're more famous, and so on and so forth. So I think crowdfunding is an extremely good model for independent, arty productions, especially for music. But it doesn't necessarily work so well for big stars, and you don't do a blockbuster with crowdfunding. You know, a blockbuster in movie, it's $300 million now, in video games as well, and in music it could be at least 80 million. So it's not something you will do with crowdfunding. So anyway, all these models are mixing a little bit all together, and we are going to see ways of funding music. And I want to make just a short point on piracy. There's been a long debate, especially in the US, with the MPAA and also the music corporation fighting the kids everywhere in the world on piracy. They have spent millions of dollars, CIA agents, and a lot of things to basically destroy the piracy, which is basically 98% in China, probably in Mexico 90%, in Brazil also. So it didn't work. I don't believe in a single second. I mean, I believe in copyright, because I think copyright is the way you will fund the artist. If you don't have copyright, you will get back to the old system, which is basically in France, the king, or in Italy, the Medicis, paying for the artist. And so maybe in this country will be Carlos Slim that will like this artist, will pay for him. I don't want this model. So I think copyright is important. But at the same time, you cannot ask the kids everywhere in the world to pay for music, especially in country where they don't have necessarily the money for that. And also because for a long time, we ask them to pay for a content that wasn't available to pay for. For example, you want them not to pay for movies, not to download illegally movies on their computer, but the movies weren't available at all, even if you want to pay. So I do think you really fight against piracy by content accessible for a very low price in the right time for everybody. And actually, we did in France a very strong law against piracy, and it was a total failure. The government basically was close to be destroyed because of the law, and everybody was against, it was President Sarkozy, of course, and it ended up being basically destroyed by the current government, just because it didn't work. You, for example, on Siri TVs, we were asking people to pay to get American Siri TVs, and then they have to wait 3 years. You know, when you have the new Glee episode, I know, I like Glee and I shouldn't say that. When you have the new episode of Glee and you have to wait 3 years, I mean, that's not possible. You will download it illegally, that's it. You want to see it now, not in 3 years. So the only solution is to provide content at the right moment on a price which is available. This is why at the end, like it or not, Netflix, and I know it's cheesy and whatever, but at least it gives a content that is legal for a price that is acceptable, less than eight, I don't know here, but it's $8 US dollars, nine US dollars in the US. In France it will be €8, I think, pretty soon. And it will work a little bit more. Some reactions or comment on this part?
For example, well, there's a very interesting case that probably was actually mainstream in terms of the consumption. That is the case of Breaking Bad. It was very interesting because it was a global conversation in the last episode of the last season of Breaking Bad. Everybody was talking about it, but just in the United States was available to watch legally this series. If you were there and watching and directly in AMC, not in another platforms. In any case, in different newspapers, for example, around the world, there was, for example, a very interesting experiment. Different newspapers were talking about the success of this show, but there was this very interesting opinion in El País. This Spanish newspaper, saying that, for example, one of the reporters tried to actually to have access legally to this last episode, but he was in Spain. So he tried to buy it with an American credit card. It was not possible because he was in Spain. So he tried to do it by means of hiring this directly in AMC, and it was not possible. So really, the only possibility to watch this series was outside of the United States was in an illegal form.
Yes, so illegal. That's it. Yes.
Something that is very kind of hypocritical is that everybody was talking about it. So
yes,
everybody
and at the same time, they want to do the global buzz. They want to do the global buzz, but they don't. It's not accessible. So, by the way, you will remark as a student that the two kind of professor here are watching Breaking Bad and Glee. So I don't know what we have to. What is the conclusion we should? I mean, that's a revelation for me. I want to go in the same.
I have two questions. One is about how is it possible to make content available if it's not only on the enterprises but on the laws of each country? Because the distribution system works. It's not that, for example, some artist doesn't want to be on Spotify in Mexico. It's that the company they signed with in Mexico doesn't have the deal with Spotify updated. Maybe they will, but that's tricky. And that's one, how do you meet the politics and the politics with the distribution? And the second is how to get distribution across multiple platforms. For example, a case, I love Game of Thrones. I watch it illegally because not only do I have to pay for...
What's your name and address and social security number?
Because I don't watch TV. So I wouldn't have to pay for cable TV and for HBO to
just
watch
for
one
that,
show.
Yes.
A friend of mine pays for both of those and has HBO Go on his on his iPad. And he stopped watching the show because he doesn't have HBO Go on his PlayStation. But he has Netflix, so he's watching Netflix. So that's another distribution problem, because not everyone can have a platform in every device.
So to answer these two questions, I mean, I believe, in this sense, I'm a very, I'm not at all in the same mood, I would say, in the same way of thinking of the cultural industry, but cultural industry will have to adapt to consumer. Consumer will be, as they have been forever, the king. And cultural industries, you know, if you come back, and I've done that in mainstream actually, if you look back in the history of the movie industry, for example, or the TV, from the beginning, from like the beginning of Hollywood, every time the industry was again against every technology change. They didn't accept radio in the beginning. You don't remember that because you haven't probably read the history of the radio. But in the beginning, when radio became step by step popular, orchestra were in strike to say, we don't want our music on the radio. Why? Because they were thinking they will lose the public in the theaters. And then when TV arrived, the movie industry said, we don't want our movie shown on TV. And then when the multiplexes arrived, everybody was against the multiplexes. And then when the pay TV arrived, everybody was against the pay TV, and so on and so forth. And it's the same with Netflix today, the same with internet. And everywhere, every time, at the end, the industry were able to work with the new technology and were even better after than before. So I'm not afraid for the cultural industry. They have to adapt, they have to change. And this is why, in a way, we have to think also of the mutations of the cultural industry themselves in two specific points. The copyright, and also what you said, basically, the distribution. How you can distribute, still be in a way to distribute, let's say, for example, in Europe. Spotify, which is a European company, wants to bring music in every European country, for example, 28 countries. You have to negotiate for every artist 28 contracts, because every European state has its own copyright rules, and some author guild and some different corporation that will have that right or the other right. This is why actually the European Commission tries, and it's of course difficult and also with some problems in both sides, to create a way to unify the copyright and to have a way to sign just one contract when you want an artist being on Spotify, and so on and so and so forth. The other question is what it means copyright. If you have seen another old American TV series, The West Wing, à la Maison Blanche, we say in France, it's, you know, the politics. And in one of the episodes, you have the president of the United States that says to a law professor, call Lawrence Lessig. You probably know this name, Lawrence Lessig, in the right. It is real name, and is actually a law professor who has been professor at Harvard, at Chicago, I think, maybe Stanford as well. And he created the, with other people, the Creative Commons copyright, which is not, of course, a solution for everything. And we had a very long battle, still have, with artists that want to be with their Creative Commons copyright, and some are also people that don't want. So it's a long battle. Once again, I'm not against copyright. On the contrary, I really think it is extremely, in a way, modern to keep copyright. But we have to adapt it. We have to adapt it for the lands. We have to adapt it by the territory it can cover, and we have also to adapt it to accept all the new mix, mélange, all these kind of things that the web allows you to do with music and movies and so on and so forth. There is also different copyright, as you know. For example, in Europe, we have what we call droit d'auteur in some countries, which is a copyright much more strong than the US copyright. So at the end, the debate will be, how can we keep copyright? Do we have to keep it in a, like, the lower way that everybody will get something, but not necessary with a lot of protection? Or do we want a base for everybody, and then for some country or some artist or different places, some categories more with more update? So all that is open, and it's a pretty complex debate. Reaction on copyright? Because it's on TV, you're on TV. Yes, on Televisa, you don't know that? 9 p.m. telenovela.
Okay, I think we've established, yeah, that in the future we're going to have all this, the new thing is going to be streaming, yeah, like you said, like Netflix, like this, Spotify. My question is, if we're going to evolve in that way, which we are right now, we can see it in the success of these companies, how new coming artists are going to, what is going to be their goal? Ultimately, in this new world, it's going to be hired by these companies, right? So everybody will be working for this company. So I'm worrying right now. I guess it's because they're getting started, but right now it kind of looks like it's monopolies, right? Here we got Netflix and that's it, right? So all the people are getting Netflix, and maybe it's the same in different countries. So maybe in the future we're gonna have two Netflixes, and as an artist, you're going to be hired by either of these companies, or how it's going to work. Maybe you can have some insight about this.
Yes, actually, it's not really a question. It's more a commentary, and I think I a little bit agree with you, in a sense that you know, as I said the first day of this free lectures, personally, I'm not against the big US corporation. I mean, think about what they have done for internet and also for us. I mean, Google is great. I love Amazon. I love Netflix. I love and many others. So we are not, I mean, it's not fair to be against them. But at the same time, a normal market economy means creating the condition to have the competitor. Actually, if Google is so powerful, it's because the US government was put on trial Microsoft for dominant position, abuse of position. And they basically destroyed a part of Microsoft. And then Google was launched at that time using the window opened by the trial. So now we have to do the same with Google to create new startup and new to avoid any monopoly. Otherwise, all the artists at the end will be employees of either Google, Apple, Facebook, or Amazon. I want to go right now on something which is not totally different, but a little bit connected, which is how cultural institutions are adapting to the web and to the internet. Basically, we were speaking mainly about cultural industries, so industries, and I want to spend some minutes on non-profit organizations, which are also important in the field of culture. And by the way, I said that a little bit the first day, but you have to keep in mind that there is a strong difference, not only in Europe, but everywhere, also in Mexico and in the US, between market and industries in culture and the non-profit sector. Everywhere, basically, in the world, libraries are not commercial. Theaters might be a little bit commercial, but in general, they are non-profit. Orchestras, operas, ballet, museums are everywhere, either public or non-profit, but they are, for a few of them, commercial. So there is a very large part of the culture we consume that it is not an industry. It is linked to public government or to non-profit organization, to philanthropy, to associations. And all this sector has also, in a way or another, the necessity or the need to adapt to the internet. Of course, the live theater, the live symphony, museums will survive even with the internet because it's not directly, it's not the internet is not a threat directly for them. But if you look at what's going on right now in this sector, you see that they change a lot. For example, if you take the San Francisco Symphony, which is an orchestra, very famous, not one of the big five in the US, but probably among the 10 more important ones. The San Francisco Symphony, of course, it is in San Francisco, which means close to the Silicon Valley. And it has a very famous director, Michael Tilson Thomas, who we call him MTT, Michael Tilson Thomas. And if you look at his web, the website of the orchestra, his Facebook account, his Twitter account, he's also on LinkedIn, of course, on YouTube, you will see the number of followers and the number of activities. So the website, it's basically another orchestra. It's the orchestra for the world. Everybody can get to the orchestra through the internet. And they have done some concerts, for example, live. And one of them, in 2011, with Michael Tyson Thomas as a conductor, got 33 million people watching. So you see how you're in an orchestra, even if it's big like it is in San Francisco Symphony, you can get maybe, I don't know, 2,000 people. On YouTube, you have 33 million. So it changed a little bit everything for the orchestra. And they want to do more. They want to have a YouTube channel for the orchestra full time. They have created some website that actually, when you listen to the music, you can go on the website and you will see all that. It's very accessible. You will follow, for example, the Tchaikovsky, let's say, symphony, and you will see the notes. So you are able to follow the music and some comments and explanation for the kids in several languages. And then, so basically, it explains you the music. It shows you how to listen the music and so on and so forth. I give you just this example, but you can go online and you will see that there is tons of other examples they have done. By the way, the project cost, I think it was 12, I don't remember precisely, but $12 million used just to create the website. So it's also something that not every orchestra are able to do. By the way, at the board, which is the conseil d'administration, the board of the orchestra, you have people from Google, from Facebook, from Twitter. And when you go to the orchestra, I was there a few months ago, you are in the top floor in the office of the director, and you see across the street, I mean, actually, it's three streets from there, but you see the logo, headquarter of Twitter, so you know where you are. And you understand why they are so in advance about the culture on the web. But I've seen other examples like that a little bit everywhere in the US and in many other countries. The Chicago Symphony Orchestra, for example, what we call the CSO in Chicago, created a radio station with images, so like YouTube, because they discovered that the people like to listen music, but at the same time to watch the orchestra. It's something very surprising, but classical music is linked to see it. And it explains why DVDs were booming a little bit. It's not the case, it won't survive, but for a long time, people were buying DVD to watch the orchestra, which is something difficult to understand, because why do you want to see an orchestra that basically, I mean, nothing happens, it's too strong to say that, but at least, in general, when you listen music, you don't necessarily want to see the orchestra. But it was interesting, so they created actually a station radio where you can see the orchestra full time, with also a media player and these kind of things. Of course, you have also many examples in museums. If you take the MoMA, for example, Museum of Modern Art in New York, they have done virtual exhibition, so it's something you can have in several websites of museums. But actually, it's extremely well done, so you can really visit the exhibition and see the paintings, and of course you can imagine all the information, documentation, complement, ads, information that you can get through this kind of website. The MFA, Museum of Fine Arts in Boston, and I visited all these museums, are also trying to do many things. If I give you all this example, I don't know if you're going to work as big managers and entrepreneurs in the field of culture, but you see how the opportunities are extremely numerous in this sector. We are just in the beginning of what will be the culture of the future. And it's not just something for the cultural industries, it's also something for the traditional arts. And think about what will be a library in the future if all the books are available online. Think about how you're going to adapt a ballet, a dance, and see what can be online, and so on and so forth. You have a very long tons of examples that you can get through this kind of examples. Have you seen any platform that you like going in this direction for traditional arts, basically trying to be more available on the web in Mexico, for example? In France, we are pretty behind. I mean, as far as I know, I mean, every museum, every orchestra in the world have a website where you can, of course, get some tickets to enter or some explanation of the day you should go and these kind of things. But this is not what I'm talking about. What I'm talking about, it's basically the museum becomes online and the symphony becoming something that you can follow even though you live thousands of kilometers where the concert is done. At the same time, YouTube wouldn't have probably been able to do this kind of channel without the San Francisco Symphony. You still need the place. You still need that something happens somewhere. Not just because you need musicians, of course, to play, but because it's also the fact that you know, actually, the concert was the 33 million people concert was in Sydney. So it was the San Francisco Symphony, but they done the concert in Sydney. So it was important that the people were able to know that that day something was happening in Sydney and they want to see it. So it's not just internet, it's also the theater in a way that works. We have also to think about, for example, I've done some research on Shakespeare and what I can call smart Shakespeare, because you might not know that, but Shakespeare is somebody very alive on the internet. You can get for zero pesos, so it's free, all the internet plays in one application. There is at least 10 or 20 models, probably also in Spanish. You get all Shakespeare in one application. I have that on my smartphone. Whenever I am free and I have time, I can read one play. So, and also you have tons of other websites. It's incredible the number of applications and websites that are dealing with Shakespeare in many ways. So things that you can do, games, translation, as you know, it's old English, so even when you speak English, it's not easy to read Shakespeare. And so the future of theater on the internet is extremely interesting as well. And in Toronto, for example, south of Toronto, there is a festival, Shakespeare Festival, that tries to be also online with many applications and services every year. And basically, you have also all the possibilities and all the things you can imagine with theater. So it's not only music, it's not only museums, it's also theater that can adapt to the internet and use internet to create new opportunities and probably, we hope, less threats. Any comments on that? Smart Shakespeare? Yes?
Sorry, it's not actually about Shakespeare. I mean, it's more about the websites. There's actually a library in Distrito Federal, I mean the capital of Mexico, that has his own website. And it's actually trying to get every book in there, in the website. I mean, they're taking every book they had and they take it on the website so you can have access in everywhere you been in Mexico. I mean, there's some people that has not libraries in his towns or something, and they are trying to do that so they can find this website and get into the library and get every every book they had and get actually access to the to those books. Another question that I had for you is actually, well, in all these kind of changes you're telling us, how did they get benefit? I mean, how did the, how may I say that? All these creators, I mean, we all know that every creator that gets something on the internet, it's in danger because they can be copied and they could be stole. I mean, his art can be stole. How did they benefit with all these changes, or how did they get protect with all these changes, or what can they do so they can get protect with all these kind of websites, new websites, or these kind of pages that they can last? Like everybody's saying, I mean, you can watch everything like for free, and the creator is like practically being stolen for his work.
Okay, at the same time, if you take the example I gave you, the San Francisco Symphony, for example, it's on YouTube, but of course, first of all, they play in Sydney. So the musicians are paid like a regular concert, so it's not stolen. And in addition, I didn't enter in the details because it's too probably too long, but in the book I do that a little bit more. They had to negotiate with the musician, and you know how in the US, in general, we think the US is like the private market and is a jungle. Like in the name of the cafe on this campus, the jungle. It is not. You have very strong unions, especially in the music industry, extremely strong also in the movie industry, in the book industry, and so on. So actually, they had to renegotiate every right to get the concert on YouTube. But they got it. They got subsidies, I don't know, by philanthropes, and they pay the musician, and basically the. I mean, on YouTube, these kind of things for 33 million people, it's of course legal. It's not an illegal concert at all. So, of course, I understand your question, but I mean, as far as done by the museums, the orchestra, the ballet, the theaters, it's in general done in a regular way. So, I mean, you have to pay the rights to and the copyright for the artists when you broadcast something, and that's just the way it is, and it's not. And we have also to invent probably new way of funding by, I mean, percentage of the publicity of YouTube, which is already the case for musicians, but probably more than that. For example, I don't want to go to some too much details. We are thinking right now in France, and I wrote a report actually a few weeks ago to the Minister of Culture in France. You know, right now there is this big debate in the US about net neutrality. The idea is, you know what is net neutrality, I'm sure, it's the idea of it's the definition of the internet from the beginning. You get every content without paying, without discrimination. So the idea is no censorship, free of expression. Every content has to be free on the internet. It was the main idea of the construction of the internet. And the Supreme Court, actually, in a famous decision in the end of the 90s, confirmed that rule. The problem with this main idea is that basically players like Google, YouTube, Netflix, especially YouTube and Netflix, because image and video are consuming a lot of broadband. They use telecommunication or cable broadband without paying it. So at the end, the net neutrality was a great idea, but the idea was to help the independent, to help the little guy, to help the arty things, and it helps today only the giant of the internet. So what we can do with that? In the US, the debate and several courts had tried to change a little bit that, and some decisions, and it's a very technical debate, ask Netflix to pay for part of the broadband they use. And actually Netflix in the US, between I think 7 and 10 p.m. every night, is 50% of the traffic of the internet. So you see, it costs a lot of the cable company, and because they are what we call over the top, they are over the top in the sense that they use the cable, they use the communication, the telecommunication, broadband, but they don't pay it. So the Federal Communication Commission tried to ask, there is still the debate currently, and President Obama said very recently that he made some that he chooses some options. The FCC is thinking in another way. The court has also a lot of fight. Several courts had taken some decision in contradiction. So we will see how will be the debate. But at least the FCC said we are going to create two ways. One way will be still net neutrality, which means everybody will get the content they want for free, without any discrimination. And then we will create a kind of new highway, more rapid, more quick, for content, especially for video, typically Netflix or YouTube. And then YouTube and Netflix will pay the cable operators to get their content at a better speed. Of course, a lot of people were against that. But this is an idea to try to fund a little bit more, in this case, telecommunication company. We in France, and actually in Europe, we are thinking of something new, which is using the same system, but in addition, recreate a real net neutrality, in the sense that we will take a part of the money that Netflix and Google will give to the telecom communications, we will take 10% or 20% of that amount to redistribute it to the content creator, not the content provider. So actually the content creator would be musician, press, movies, producers, and so on, and not to Google, of course, and Netflix. So it will be like the idea of basically using, re-giving to the content what Google takes to them, what actually the telecom lost, and so on. So it's like what we call a cercle vertueux. How do you say that in English?
Virtual circle.
Easy. So I don't know if it's going to happen one day. I mean, it was an idea. I work with the minister, and we are trying to find a solution to fund. It's also, of course, a solution that fund the French system and not the American one. So it's also a way to try to be smart against, at the same time. And everybody at the end is happy by that, because Netflix is happy to have a speed very quick to get to the homes. Telecom company gets some money. And if they have, let's say, $100 and you take 20, they still have 80. So they are happy to have 80. And of course, the producers of music or movies are very happy to have 20. So it's like a way to create this virtual circle, this an opposite of the Catch 22, a good Catch 22, to fund content. Again, I don't know if it will work one day, but at least we have to think of new ideas, new proposition like that. And it's always also a way to create, with the US, we have to create some, what can I say, some, once again, I'm a very free market person, so I don't think we are going to say Netflix cannot come to France, or we don't want YouTube. Of course, they are welcome. But we have, at the same time, to create some ways not to have all the content that will be free for them, and basically the money not for the French. And I think it's exactly the same position you have to create in Mexico, even though it is not a very typical way of thinking, I guess, in this country. I give you another example to be more, because I'm not sure my smart net neutrality is totally clear for you. Do you know how we fund the French movie industry? How do you do that? How do we do that?
Some of the copyright of the creator, and the creator doesn't have any utilities because it's funded for the government. So the government has the, yeah, no?
What we do, it's a, I mean, actually it's a great idea. Quite often I'm not in favor of the French system. I think it's too protectionist, too in kind of thinking of the culture as an exception, too nationalistic. But this one is pretty great and actually could have been done in Mexico. And if it would have been done here, you will probably have a better movie industry in this country. What we have decided a long time ago, actually, it's a decision just after the war. We create a tax, which is not a government one, by the way. It has been created by the theater themselves. I mean, the place where you go to see a movie. When you pay, let's say, 10 euro to see a movie, we take 13% of this price. And the money, so basically everyone that goes to see one movie, everyone in the country, pays in the price of the ticket, 13%, that goes to the CNC, which is a public body but independent to the Ministry of Culture, and the CNC, the Centre National du Cinéma, Cinematograph Center National, basically, get all this money. And all this money is used to produce French movies. So the system is pretty smart in a way that it's not quotas. Like in South Korea, they have done quotas, which means you cannot show more than 50% of American movies, and the other one has to be from South Korea. In China, they have said we allow only 10 American movies a year. We don't do that. We said Americans are welcome. You can see as much as American movies as you want, because at the end, as much as the blockbuster works, as much as the French system get money. So actually, the French system is paid by the American blockbuster. So we can say at the end that all the crap, intellectual, arty French movies that even me, I don't want to see, are paid by Spider-Man and Batman. But at the end, we have 50% of our box office, which is for French movies. And it's without any censorship, without any quotas. It's just a way to tax every movies to get a way to fund the French one. And this is something you can do in Mexico. I mean, of course, the American will be very unhappy by that. I know, because they have fought against the French system for a long time without any success. But at least it's a very, I mean, it's nationalistic, if you want, in one way. But at the same time, it doesn't hurt competition. It doesn't hurt pluralism. You can see whatever you want. There is, I mean, and this is why the French are so happy when an American blockbuster works well, because they get more money. So at the end, it's a win-win, I would say, situation. And it's done outside of the government, because the tax is not a government one, but it's decided by the French, I would say, producer and distributors all together. I want to now finish this lecture today by a conclusion, I would say, first of all about culture and content, and maybe a more general one on what I've said in the three lectures. And I will speak a little bit on something I really believe in, which is curation. The problem, the main problem of the web, of the internet, I would say, it's, and it's also its quality, it's at the same time opportunity and threat, is abundance. As we said before, we can get everything for free, more or less, everything from anywhere, everything for anyone, everything from the big guy, the bad guy, from the elite, from the popular one, from rumor, from terrorism, from pornography, whatever you can imagine. And it's great. In a way, it is the way Internet has been built, which means no discrimination. Any content can be on the web. And I believe, you might not agree with me on that, that this American way of thinking of the Internet is better than the Chinese or the Iranian one that basically think they have to decide what is good for the people. I think it's better you decide for yourself. At the same time, the limit of that is, of course, how you can find, how you can choose, how you can be, and sometimes you won't, be, find some advice. And this is all the debate about curation. We had, for a long time, this kind of elite way of thinking of culture with the so-called prescriptors. Could be cultural critics, academics, professors, could be a TV show that were saying to you, you should read this book because, let's say, Michel Foucault is better than the guy that nobody knows. And that actually, it's better to watch this movie before the other one, and you need to be educated. And it's what the very, for a very long time, centuries actually, the kind of European way of the elite saying to the people what they have to pick. And then today we have, and it has been a debate of our discussion today, the algorithm, and you have that on Amazon, you have that on Spotify, you have that on Netflix, as I said before. Steam also has that for video games, you have the same at Scribd for books and so on and so forth. Then the algorithm say to you, this is what you should see because people, mass of people, are thinking the same way of you, and basically because they like that, you should like that. So you have the two extremes, the elite kind of model and the very popular one, the algorithm, that will use millions of people, datas, to tell you what you should watch, what you should buy, what you should read. I believe in a middle ground. You know, Europeans are always a little bit in the middle, you know, middle of the road. I think the time of the elite deciding for everybody is over. I mean, I wrote a chapter on the end of the critic, the literary critic in mainstream. The movie critic today, have you seen any movie because you read a critic by a movie critic? I don't. Do you buy a book because an intellectual somewhere in the world will say to you, you have to buy this book? I don't. I think it's finished. The idea of this kind of top-down elite system that will show you what you should read doesn't work and won't work. At the same time, I'm not totally satisfied by the algorithm system that will give you the advice just because millions of people are thinking like you. And this is how there is a place, I would say a window, for what I call in the book and what is something I really like, smart curation. The mix of the recommendation by people you trust and algorithm at the same time. Not one or the other, but both at the same time. In a way, it's already what exists. When you go, when you use Facebook, for example, when you like something, it's typically smart curation. Why? Because it's you or your friends that give an advice to other friends. And it's just somebody that you trust that give you an advice. And at the same time, Facebook use that to create datas and actually give to other people some advice. So it's already a mix of algorithm and a more prescriptive recommendation. In a way, Twitter, with when you retweet something, is also a kind of smart curation. So I do believe that we have, and it is probably something we have to do in the future, we have to invent this mix of having a large number of people, an algorithm to give an advice about things that are important to read, put content to buy, and at the same time, the necessity to have, people that will tell you what is necessary, what is good, also in which order you should read something, for example. So we need cool hunter, buzz researcher, but also prescriptor at the same time. So this is basically what I think about smart curation. Any comment on that? How do you see this debate?
And how do you see that can be achieved? This, I mean, besides what Facebook tells you, or based on what your friends recommend, what if you're not on internet, or how will that work?
Actually, tons of websites are already doing that. I mean, you have, it depends on the sector, but in many sectors, you have curators that actually tell you things, and you like this one or the other one because it's more close to... Let's take another example, it's more personal, but I created a few years ago a website in France, which is a book review critic website. And we have done that with basically 900 people, critics, that are not just the elite, because 900, it's a lot. It's much more than, I mean, I don't know, in the literary supplement of Le Monde, there is maybe 10 people that write. So we have 900. And they are young, and they published. The idea was everyone has to publish one book review a year. And my idea was simple. If all of them do one a year, we have three every day. And it's basically what we have. We have even five every day right now. The website title is nonfiction.fr, because it's only books of nonfiction. There is no fiction. It's only history, economics, and these kind of things. So, of course, it's more an experimentation. It's not professional. We have an office and two internships, but this is not, and it's a non-profit organization, so it is not a big corporation. But at least we have shown that it's possible for nonfiction to find people that are not the elite, but they are not only the masses. There are people that know a little bit what they are talking about, and there is many ways also to judge what they are wrote, to correct if they do some mistake, of course to be very ethics based, which means they cannot write about a book of their professor or in the publisher they are, or somebody which direct their PhD or things like that. And I mean, I'm not sure it's perfect, but at least it's a good experimentation to see how you are able to publish critics, and actually from very good quality, about books. And you have to think, you have to remember that even in France, where it's a country supposed to be very intellectual, with a lot of newspaper, literary newspaper, and so on, the majority of books that are published in French don't even have one critic. You know, all the academic books, and actually, for example, this week, this is the La Rentrée Littéraire in France, which means like the books, the new novels are getting in bookshops. And we got, I think it's 800 new novels by new writers. So it's incredible. Not a lot of countries can have 800 every year new novelists with a new book. And among the 800 or 900, how many will get a review? Maybe 50, maybe 100 maximum. So it's very important for writers at least to have somebody that read your books and give an advice, even though it's maybe not a good one. And actually this week, and I spent part of my night last night reading that, actually one of the books that was published yesterday, no, we are Thursday today. Yes, t- today, actually, it's published today. It's the book by the former wife of the French president, and the press is speaking only about this one. So I'm not even sure 100 will get some review, because everybody is commenting, is making comment about this crazy book. I mean, it's the first time maybe in the world that the wife of a president is basically explaining everything, even how they were in bed and things incredible. I mean, they went separate a few months ago, and it was a very bad story. So she's extremely jealous, extremely mean, and she wants to destroy the French president. And I think she is in her way to succeed, and with a lot of secrets and many other things. And for example, she said, you know, President Hollande said he doesn't like rich people. And she said, it's not true. He doesn't like poor people. And he called them in private tits less, you know, without tits. And the expression, I can tell you, will stay for Hollande for a very long time, because it's extremely, I mean, especially for a socialist president, to be so mean against the poor people will be, and we can believe it's probably true what she said, but the question is more, does she have to write the book or not? But this is a debate. So basically, this idea of, you have tons of websites in the world today, in many startups that try to find a solution how you correct algorithm, how you make them more efficient, how you add personal feeling, personal recommendation, how you use data and use people to ameliorate the algorithm. So we are in the middle of the process of the smart curation expression that I use. We will see. But I don't believe in a world that will be still managed by the so-called elite, but I don't believe neither, in a way, in the world that will be just regulated, that the prescription, that the recommendation will be made only by the mass of people. So the minority is not good, the majority is not good either, probably a middle ground.
But don't you think it's a natural way that those platforms, like the one you created, or for example, I think of Rotten Tomatoes or IMDb, suddenly become the elite, and it's not a person that has some credentials to say something, but you maybe you may watch a movie because it got a good grade in Rotten Tomatoes. So maybe this process of smart, how do you say, smart curation, only gives this elite position to collectives and not to people.
It's a part of the answer, but I mean, I do think that it is an extremely interesting moment, and in a way, in a way, I try to be, and while I write it about that, I try to be in that moment, which means the question is not today to be against the internet or against new technologies. And this is why I'm so fed up, sometimes even pissed off, by people like Finkielkraut in France, Vargas Llosa, or others that are thinking of what is culture and basically how it is destroyed by globalization and the internet. I don't think it's a good approach. I do think you have to live with your time, and you have to go to see what's going on the future. And actually, we are very lucky, because even though I'm older than you, we have been able to know culture before the internet. And we have had some video and some, you know, these whole things that was called CD, and we know what is a book. It's not absolutely sure that the three kids of this professor will know books. So basically, it is great to be to live today, to be in the middle of the transition. We are in this transition. You know, when you read Alexis de Tocqueville, which is the very famous historian, French one, that when he arrived in the US, he wrote De la démocratie en Amérique, and he was also the he was a very Christian Catholic and royalist aristocrat that wrote the history of the French Revolution. And you can be, when you are like him, just afraid, and even more than that, I mean, terrorized by the French Revolution, which was destroying all the things you were, especially the aristocracy, the king, and all this kind of thing. Instead, he wrote this book about the Ancien Régime et la Révolution to, I mean, not because he liked what was coming, but just he knew that you don't go back. You don't get back to the past. You just have to go away. I mean, to not away, you have to go on. So, not backyard, not backward, forward. I was trying to find the word. So, not backward, but forward. And then he writes, you know, of course, all the walls, all the things that were our system is destroying, are destroying. We are now in a world, we walk in a road that we don't know where it goes, but we know this is the road we have to take. In a way, it's a little bit the same with the internet. We are not going to think, okay, it was better before, or we should protect our culture. And if I was very, I would say, moved when I was in Dubai, in Mumbai, in Rio, even here in Mexico, even in places like sometimes where you don't even expect that, in Saudi Arabia, in Lebanon, in Indonesia, you have quite often in front of you a kid who is 25, 28 years old, and he's in charge of a startup, he's building a business, and he has his eyes very large open. He open also his arms and he says, you know, I want to go on the internet and to benefit of these opportunities. Quite often in front of that in Europe, or even sometimes in the US, you have this old manager of the big cultural industries that are 75 plus old, that are afraid, and they only discourse is about protecting the culture of the past. So I think the best way to do it is to think of the culture of the future. Of course, you have to protect copyright, you have to think of, I mean, not everything has to be destroyed, but at least you have to go where it is to be the future. And in a way, it is a little bit what I tried to tell you during these 3 days, even though I was pretty sick, so it's not very easy for me in general to speak in English, and it's even more difficult when you try to to keep your voice ready and working. But I have just 10 more minutes, so I think I will survive. I tried to give you some just some flavor, because of course it's not in just a few hours that you can give like in a conference in English all the idea, the impression, the information you get for like 4 or 5 years of research in 50 countries, meaning 2,000 or 3,000 people around the world, asking them tons of questions and trying to give to the people that read your books an impression of what they told you, but at least give you a flavor of the opportunities that you have. And I think, and I'm not saying that because I just want to be friendly with you, I think you have, being in Mexico, being in this kind of school, being young as well, is you have a lot of chance to be in this situation. Because Europe, it's something else. Outside of the academic, or when you are older, it's also something else. So many opportunities are in front of us. We are just, I really believe in that, we are just in the beginning of the internet revolution. I do think that the future of the internet, as I said in the first day, is not a global conversation that everybody will join and that you should be American in the Silicon Valley to succeed. I think it has been the case for one part. It will be still a very Silicon Valley oriented culture for a long time, but you will have multiple platforms, multiple websites, and content won't travel well. Conversation won't be global. The internet will be more and more fragmented, and then opportunities to be in the right niche will exist much more in the future than it is the case today. My only goal with my two books, because they are connected, mainstream more on cultural industries and globalization, and smart more on digitalization, are in a way to try to show how internet is not something abstract. It's very concrete. This is why I had to go on the ground to speak with people, to see how websites are working, how you create content. It's not something that it is somewhere inaccessible in the cloud, global, far away from you, far away from your language, your culture, your identity. On the contrary, it is extremely linked. It is extremely, I would say, depending of your culture, your identity, your language. And this is why being in an emerging country, and sorry for the condescending expression of emerging like this one, it is a very good, rich opportunity that you have. At the end, I really believe that internet doesn't destroy frontiers, as I said the first day. On the contrary, it makes them more important and more valuable, even though you can also cross the borders quite often in many aspects. But still, the place where you are is extremely important on the internet. To conclude, I will say that I hope these 3 days of discussion are not just a speech like other one. I constantly update all the information I have, and also using my new travels on Twitter, on Facebook, and also on my website. I will update my book, so I think the Spanish edition will have new update, especially from Cuba, where I was and where I got this cold. And also, I will try to be back here if it's possible, and I hope you enjoy this discussion. I will stay this afternoon on campus, so if you need any exchange or any discussion, I'm available, and I would like to thank you to have been with us. Thanks.
Questions?
I'll have one. What do you think is going to be the role of internet in the creation of critical thinking?
I will answer you with a kind of joke. I was in a TV show pretty famous in France a few years ago, so of course they wouldn't do that, they wouldn't say that today. And I was with some people, and we were speaking about Twitter, And they were against Twitter. I don't know why. I mean, I know why. And they said, you know, how can you defend Twitter as something where you can get information when it's just 140 signs? And I just answered to them, yes, you just have to know that on Twitter you put a link, and the link could be your PhD. So you can, my PhD, 3,800 pages, can be linked to Twitter. So that's just the answer. So I don't think Twitter or the internet in general is something you have to say, does it could be critical or not? Will it give you any good content or bad? You know, this is not good or bad by itself. It depends of how you use it. It depends of what you put on it. It depends of how you are able to use it. Today, academic and scientific journals are on the internet. I don't think you can say science is not available on the internet. It is. So then the question, and this is how I go back on what I said in the first class, the question is not today the digital divide. It's more the digital literacy, which means how you educate people, but educate in a good sense, not just, you know, saying this is good and this is bad, but how you are able to, you know, Wikipedia is great. I love it, in contradiction of many French scholars that are spending all their class to say to their students, don't go to Wikipedia. I think it's great. I mean, if you use the English version, extremely professional, you have pages are extremely accurate, but it's true that there is also mistake. And there is also things that are totally crazy on Wikipedia. So you have to learn. This is just something you have to teach also in a way. So I will think digital literacy is probably one of the key things that has to be teach on a campus like this one. But also we have to probably, this is why also I believe in smart curation, we have also to create website, application, and all these kind of things that will help the people to empower them to be able to judge by themselves in a better way.
How we as a community manage to get internet as free as it is, or as free as we want it to be? And my question is reference to an experience that I had this summer when I watched a documentary about Aaron Swartz and his life and work on Reddit, and how he tragically died trying to get internet to be free against all these big corporations, because behind everything there's money, and when people have money, they have power, and we are on their hands. So what can we do to keep internet as free as possible, or to kick out these people who want it to be private and to be closed, and who have the power to do so?
I mean, this is why I believe in Firefox, I believe in Wikipedia, I believe in Creative Commons, I believe in operator systems that are not necessarily commercial. I mean, again, I'm not against the market, because without the market, you will have probably internet as it is today. So it's probably good to have big corporations and a lot of money in this sector. Internet costs a lot of money. I mean, building Facebook is not easy. Otherwise, other guy will have done that easily. The thing is, then you have also to create regulation. This is why I'm not a total free market person. I do believe in regulations, like actually the big US agency, the Rooseveltian spirit still has to be influenced at the FCC, at the FTC, at the antitrust division of the Department of Justice in the US. And if they don't do that, the European Union, or maybe here in Mexico, regulators are to be working on that. Even though it's a joke, but the last time I came here in Mexico, I went to see the regulator. I don't remember the name, and probably you don't, because when I see the guy, he said, I'm very happy to meet you because you are writing about regulations of telecoms in Mexico. You should know that we have been demanded yesterday, so we are not existing anymore. So the regulator was dying the day when I was visiting them. They create a new one now, so I don't know if it's better or worse. But he told me that regulation is a big issue in a country like this one. But I know that the current president is trying to change a little bit this kind of two monopoles in telecommunication and television. We'll see. It's true also that, you know, the difference between a Democrat and a Republican believes in one regulator and the Democrat believes in three. So maybe there is a competitor, sorry. The Republican thinks one competitor is enough and the Democrat thinks three are necessary. So maybe in between two is already good, but you don't necessarily have two on TV, even though you have TV Azteca, and you need probably two big ones on telecoms. Otherwise, it's difficult to have a cheap broadband, accessible, free, quick, everywhere in the country.